Welcome back to the Digital Health and Wearables series. Today I have another magnificent episode for you, another leader, innovator. But before I go ahead, let me remind you to subscribe to the channel. Also check all the previous content there in healthcare and share with your communities. Let me also acknowledge our partners, our series partner Fujifilm Healthcare and our industry partner Isaac Care. And today it gives me great pleasure to introduce you to Ron Fridman. Is the CEO and co-founder of Mawi. Ron, how are you?
Good. Thank you very much. Thanks for your support. Thank you for the invitation.
Oh, brilliant. Thank you for accepting. I know you're doing something really great, very innovative company. You're going to tell us all about that in the medtech and wearable space. And today we are here to talk about the missed puzzle in cardiac monitoring from diagnostics to patient management. And the first question that I have for you is, the future of remote cardiac monitoring, how long the patient should be monitored, how often, and which devices are more suitable?
Yeah, thank you very much. It's very, very relevant question because just now I came back a couple of weeks ago from the Barcelona, from European Society of Cardiology Congress, which was probably the one of the main events in Europe and the whole world as well. And a lot of speakers talked about the outcomes of last year's clinical trials. And the biggest issue now that we do not have any final evidence, how much time do you need to be monitored to find the AFib? This is the first question. And the second one question, what will happen if we'll find this AFib? Should we proceed with anticoagulants or we need ablation or we just need to monitor this patient one more and one more? You know that it's a different approach now available from the market. So we can start from the application, from a camera-based PPG approach to detect AFib and to screen patients. We can proceed with some devices like Alive Core with single lead ECG. We can have more advanced devices for long-term cardiac monitoring, is Holter devices for 24 hours or patch wearable devices, which are brilliant now, like up to 4 or 2 weeks devices with cardiac monitoring. We could proceed with event loop recorders or even implantable devices. But let's say majority of speakers agreed that the median to monitor patients and to find the main outcomes and to be confident that AFib not missed on the patient side, it's 2 weeks monitoring from the patch. First of all, because it's very convenient, very easy to apply, and our company is exactly from the same niche, from exactly from this domain. We provide cardiac monitoring up to 7 days on one device. And our main idea to make this process very easy to use for patient and very, let's say, painless for doctor. So all process is very streamlined. From the patient enrollment to the final report, it takes 7 days. There is no need to wait for reports for half a year and so on, like it was before. There is no need to spend a lot of time to teach nurses how to attach all these wires on the chest. So device is very, very flexible, very easy to use. And our device is disposable, probably, which is the biggest difference on the industry, that our device is single use. So you can attach this device on yourself at a clinical office or at your home. You can mail back this device or upload data from the application, and you can receive the final report at the healthcare provider, at the cardiologist, in 24 hours from the data uploaded to our cloud. So I would say that the golden standard for today is extended Holter monitoring, which is very efficient, which is affordable for clients, for insurance, for all payers, and which is very high yield by the quality of the data and outcomes which we could receive.
Brilliant. Ron, thank you very much for that brilliant overview and also mentioning some of the reliable options in the marketplace, including your company, of course, but you mentioned other names, which is great because one of the challenges, as you know, is people always challenge the accuracy, the reliability, and also the quality of the data. So you mentioned some really great names there. moving on to the second question. Second question is, talking wearables compliance, elderly people could not deal with existing wearables from the market. What do you say about that?
Yeah, I would say that probably the painless moment of the whole wearables for today and digital health technologies, majority of these technologies are really brilliant. So I've tested probably almost each technology which is now available from the market. Because first of all, because I'm CEO of the company from this niche, but on the other hand, I'm very, you know, kind of geeky guy who tried to test all devices from the market. And I'm curious about some technologies, approaches, but majority of these technologies, they developed for, let's say, less elderly population, probably 50 years plus, probably up to 60 years. And it's really good for sure, let's say, to provide some populational screening like Apple Watch did before. It's really a very, very big challenge and they done it. And it's really very, very cool. But the probably the missed puzzle in the whole cardiac monitoring scope, it's really elderly people. I mean, seniors, probably people 70 years plus, 80 years plus, 90 years plus. I guess it will make the, let's say, statistical analysis. And let's say, based on the last research, I guess our colleagues from Sweden, they've done an AFA study. It was a big clinical trial. More than 20,000 patients on board, and they tried to measure the risk of the AFib on the stroke. And probably the biggest outcome and insight, we received at the clinical community that it should be monitored as, let's say, for elderly people, because for younger generation, it's very difficult to catch some signs of AFib. There are a lot of false positives. And it will not influence if even you will find some small AFib burden. Okay, you will have AFib burden, let's say 2 hours per 24 hours, or let's say 1 hour per 3 days monitoring. What should you do with this AFib burden? Because let's say technically it's AFib, because we have like 1 hour of the AFib on the screen. But is it enough AFib to, let's say, to proceed with anticoagulants or not? So, and majority of, let's see, really like huge, like, but silent AFib cases, they came from the elderly people. I mean, really elderly people. That's why majority of devices are not very efficient on the elderly population, especially for populational management. Because if we are talking about screening, okay, you can proceed with Holter device or with patch wearable device or implantable loop recorder, doesn't matter. You will find some signs of AFib, you will find this burden. But what will be the next stage? Okay, you will have this patient, probably you will make ablation, you will prescribe ablation for this patient, but what should be the next stage? Does this person require to be monitored for a long time, for years? And I would say yes. It's called like management, patient management. And in this patient management, we need to consider not only AFib, we need to consider all other comorbidities. So we need to think about probably heart failure as well. We need to think about hypertension. We need to think about a lot about the sleep apnea, which is a huge problem. So that's why I would say that this wearable should be really patient friendly. I mean, especially elderly people friendly. What it means? The battery life should be as power as you can. So up to 1 month in our case. All data collection should be absolutely passive. There is no room for the intervention between patient and device, because elderly people, they are not so good in device communication and so on. They cannot work with some mobile applications, with companion apps and so on. They just need something on the wrist or on the chest or on the ears. I don't know. It doesn't matter, on the nose, but something which could be a passive device to monitor all main vital signs. And the last but not least, that this data should go directly from the device to the cloud. There is no need to have some hub devices or mobile applications, companion apps, relay devices, because all this chain will dramatically increase patient flow and patient compliance will be really decreased like multifold. That's why what we created, it's totally Wi-Fi based device. We stream data directly from the edge device, from the skin of the patient to the cloud, without any interventions, without any auxiliary technologies.
Brilliant. Ron, thank you so much. And you mentioned very important factors there to remove the barriers, being like user-friendly, specific for the elderly population, but also the compliance side of things, no data transfer, integration, security, all these things, privacy, all these things that are attached to kind of in front of the innovation, they're just barriers. So you mentioned a lot of really important things. Thank you so much. Moving on to the third and last question, is medical grades and diagnostic capabilities from medical devices versus awareness and wearability from the consumer world? What do you have to say on that?
Yeah, I would say, based on the clinical trials evidence as before in my previous topics, because I would say that, you know, different opinions from different even opinion leaders, brilliant minds, it's just personal view. But if we are talking about the clinical trial outcomes, it's much more mature because it's like evidence-based medicine. So that's why, based on the last populational screenings, I would say that consumer wearables was not so efficient in AFib detection. From one hand. From other hand, we just finished a big screening, AFib screening, which was absolutely efficient and very, very impressive that they find two more times AFib if compared to just basic checkup. But in the end of the day, consumer wearables, they are oriented on multi-use features. You know, in consumer wearables, you will have like mobile phone, you will have some your messaging, you will have some sport application, some mindfulness applications, sleep applications, and one more feature, ECG-based, let's say, AFib detection. It's good, but let's say to make populational screening, it's not enough. Because from one hand, all populational screenings are required by European Cardiac Society. So it's like a guideline-based. On the other hand, consumer wearables still not so efficient to find AFib or other comorbidities, other recent abnormalities or hypertension on patients. That's why I would say that it should be a new era of wearable devices, which will be totally medical devices without any auxiliary features. Because wearable device, especially for elderly people, I would say that probably 80 years old grandma, let's say my grandma, she's not so required to have Facebook or some messaging, instant messaging from the Facebook on her watch. Yes, she's mostly required to be monitored about fall detection cases, about respiratory rate problems, about sleep apnea problems, about heart rhythm problems. It's much more important for her to be monitored by these parameters than to have some notification from the Facebook. So I would say that now it's a huge room for, let's say, medical devices, which will be designed totally by the medical guidelines, by all ISO standards, which will pass FDA, MDR, and so on, but which could be much more, let's say, sexy by the appearance, by the, let's say, visual, aesthetical design than classical medical devices. You can just imagine from the past, yes, like some bulky devices with a lot of wires and so on. That's why I guess this is a time when two industries will meet each other, but there is no chance to be half of medical, half of consumer. You should be or medical or you should be consumer device. There is no room for to be in the middle of these two niches. That's why, for sure, I guess, as entrepreneurs, we need to learn best from the consumer. If we are in the medical business, if we are still in the consumer business, we need to apply some features as Apple did, as Samsung did, as Xiaomi did, and other vendors to apply some features from the medical field, but still to be consumer-oriented. I guess this is the future of this market.
Yeah, very, very good insights. And also the point of like being in the middle of, you are, I was actually in an event in London this week, and it was wellness wearables, you know, consumer orientated. Because sometimes, as you know, some of the devices in the marketplace, you give this mixed message, oh, we have some medical data, but we're not a medical device. So, you know, it's a confusion for the consumer, for companies, for providers, and everything. Ron, very interesting discussion. I love talking to you. I mean, you know your stuff, which is brilliant. And we come to the end of the episode. I finish all my episodes in a peculiar way. It's not a question. It's called 1 minute of fame. You can mention anything, a company, you can mention any projects, anything, personal life. We're talking before the show about some of our actually things that we have in common in life. So to round up the interview, 1 minute of fame, over to you.
So first of all, you know that I'm Jewish, I'm Ukrainian. That's why I want to thanks to all people around the world, around the globe who supported Ukraine now. It's very important for me because it's like a painful in my life for today, and very, very proud that majority of the population of the whole world, they're really supporting us. So thank you very much to all. I will use this stage to say this words of thanks. This is the first one. The second one, I would say that I'm absolutely surprised and I'm absolutely happy that I'm in this niche of the remote patient monitoring, because I would say that a couple of years ago, I was like struggling. Is it the right decision to be in this niche? Do our company make the right choice to be a part of the cardiac monitoring field, which is overcrowded by devices, which is overcrowded by technologies? It's very, very difficult to reach cardiologists because they're very like famous people. They're very busy and so on. But in the end of the day, our company on the everyday basis, we save people's lives. So even now in our business, we didn't count like each saved life, because I would say that it's not true that only our company saved life, because it's a process, you know. Once using our device, somebody will be like diagnosed with AFib, a long chain of the people, of cardiologists, electrophysiologists, nurses, drivers of the ambulance, and so on. All these people are involved in saving life of the people. But in the end of the day, our company have a small place in this life-saving company around the globe, yes? So I'm very happy that we continue with our remote patient monitoring. I want to say that we have a brilliant team, really one of the most probably professional team in the world. I'm very happy that all we created from this scratch in-house in our company. All our ideas, all our technologies was created by our company. So we have some partnerships for sure. We have some brilliant providers, subcontractors, but majority of our, let's say, main innovations was created by my co-founders, by my brilliant team. And for sure, I guess it's a perfect place to say thanks for them, for the huge impact and for the huge influence on the whole remote patient monitoring industry, which I would say that it's very important. And I'm confident that the future is in remote patient monitoring in different fields for different patient cohorts, but all cases of like hospital at home will be much more popular in the future. And I guess it will be dramatically increase efficiency of the healthcare around the globe.
Brilliant. Ron, thank you so much. Great way to finish with your acknowledgements and your vision and everything. Thank you so much for accepting the invite. I wish you all the best. The world is behind you, Ukraine, and hopefully the situation would improve very, very soon. I'm delighted to have you here.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the invitation. Thanks for your support. Thank you very much.
Brilliant. I'm going to round up now to our viewers and listeners. Let me remind you to subscribe to the channel. Also, I'm going to post Ron's details here, his company, his links, connect with him on LinkedIn. He's very knowledgeable. Ask about Mawi innovation and find opportunities to partner with them. And also let me acknowledge our partners, the series partner Fujifilm Healthcare, and our industry partner Isaac Care. And I'll see you all next week.